At 10:55 a.m., Dr. Miner came to the bottom gate, which was locked, and called out, "You had better send for the medical officer. I have injured myself." I sent for the medical officer and went to see if I could assist Dr. Miner. Then he told me he had cut his penis off. He said he had tied it with string, which had stopped the bleeding. I saw what he had done. He was removed to the B3 infirmary at 11:30 a.m. He had taken his walk before breakfast as usual. He took his breakfast. I was talking to him at 9:50 in Ward 3 when he appeared to be just as usual. But he was not just as usual. Since the laws of nature could explain all natural phenomena, he could not find any logical need for the existence of a god. However, over the years in the asylum, these feelings began slowly to ameliorate. By the turn of the century, Miner had changed. He was telling visitors and formally informing the Broadmoor superintendent that he now regarded himself as a deist, someone who accepts the existence of a god, but does not subscribe to any particular religion. It was an important step, and yet, in its own way, a tragic one. It looks as though William Miner had been planning his act of self-mutilation for several days, if not months. Cutting off his penis was, by his lights, a necessary and redemptive act. For Miner began to judge himself by the harsh standards of an all-purpose, all-seeing, and eternally vindictive deity. He stopped thinking of his insanity as a treatable sadness, and instead took to thinking of it as an intolerable affliction, a state of sin that needed constant punishment. He began to regard himself as someone inexpressibly vile, endowed with dreadful habits. He was a compulsive masturbator. God would be certain to punish him dreadfully. His prodigious sexual appetites started to become particularly abhorrent to him. He began to be haunted by the memory of past sexual conquests. He began to loathe the way his body responded and the way that God had so inappropriately equipped him. He believed there had been a complete saturation of his being with the lasciviousness of over 20 years. His organ had increased in size as the result of such constant use. He remembers a French woman remarking, "Bien fait," on first seeing it. Another woman called him an apostle of pleasure. But when he became Christianized, he saw that he must sever himself from the lascivious life that he had been leading. The surgical removal of the penis is at best a dangerous practice, rarely performed even by doctors. It's a desperate man who will remove one's own organ, the more so when the operation is done in an unsterile environment and with a penknife. Among his many perks, Dr. Miner had enjoyed the superintendent's permission to carry a penknife. It had long ceased to be of much use. Few were the occasions when he had to cut the unfinished pages of first editions, which is why he had asked for the knife in the first place. Now it just sat in his pocket, as it might in that of an ordinary man on the outside world. Except that Miner was in no senses ordinary, and now had an unusual and pressing need for the knife. He was desperately certain that it was his penis that had led him to commit all the unsavory deeds that had so dominated his life. His continuing sexual desires, if not born in his penis, were at least carried out by it. He felt he had no alternative but to remove it. He was a doctor, of course, and so knew roughly what he was doing. That Wednesday morning, he sharpened his knife on a whetstone. He tied a thin cord tightly around the base of his member to act as a ligature and to pressure cauterize the blood vessels. He waited for 10 minutes or so until the vein and artery walls had become properly compressed, and then, in one swift movement that most would prefer not to imagine, he sliced off his organ about 1 inch from its base. He threw the offending object into the fire. He relaxed the string. There was almost no blood. He lay down for a while to ensure there was no hemorrhage, and then walked almost casually to the lower gate and called for the attendant. The penis steadily healed, leaving a small stump through which Miner could urinate, but to his presumed satisfaction, proved to be useless sexually. The problem had been solved.